to this radioactive plane and try to use it for his displacement. That is what is going to happen within the next few decades. That is, after the experiments are successful, a person goes into a cabin, closes himself in the cabin, and marks the required station where he has to get down, and then presses the button just as we do in the elevator. And instead of the elevator traveling, the physical body of the fellow will disappear. The cells of the body will disappear into the atomic and pre-atomic state, and they go into the radioactive plane, and within a few seconds they will reappear in another cabin in the required station. For example, if he disappears in Munich, he appears in New York. This is what is meant by travel without displacement. This is only here in this, in my book. This is what I predict about the aquarian age. Because when we apply our mind to the principles that are working in the age, we can understand some things. Of course, Blavatsky predicted that there will be a space age, and the human being will be a master of space. Whereas, towards the end of the 19th century, he was a slave of matter. That is what she predicted. Towards the end of 19th century, the scientists were a slave of matter. Towards the end of the 20th century, he will be a master of space. That is what she predicted in the previous century. And this is my own application of the Aquarian principle to understand what happens about the discoveries of the human being. So I said, gaining space and time, this is an example of space. There will be a conquest over time also. He travels into the future and the past. Traveling into the past is just a little bit possible in the fastest aeroplane even now. If we take an aeroplane and if it is after sunrise, we can get down from the plane before sunrise of the same day. This much man has achieved till now. But this is not actually traveling into the future or past. This is only taking advantage of the local sunrise. In fact, man is only in the present. But here, in the Aquarian age, in the future, he will travel into the past or future. Of course, mentally, not physically. Physically, it is not possible to travel through time. Physically, the experiment of traveling without displacement will be conquered. And mentally, he gains success in traveling through time. For example, he travels into the Atlantean age. And then he reads, just as we read a book, the existence of certain buildings and certain cities and towns. And then immediately he goes into the depth of the earth or ocean to locate that particular town or city that is submerged under the ocean. And he picks up the things which he found in his investigation. For example, if he has found in his study an emblem in a particular city, and if the emblem is of a peculiar shape, if he wants to go into the investigation of why the emblem was made by the Atlanteans, immediately he marks the place or longitudes and latitudes in his mind during his studies of the past, and then he makes an excavation under the earth where that particular stone is existing for the present. He brings it out, makes his investigation. So these two things will become possible in the Aquarian age. That is what I mean, gaining time and space. Similarly, he travels into the future also. He can travel into the 21st or 22nd centuries and can understand the position of the Earth globe and the possible new dimensions of chemicals on this Earth and the extent of some of the present chemicals, and he makes his investigations accordingly. And also he understands the dangers of the present day civilization. What happens when the present human being is developing his technology in the same way as he is doing now? In what respects he is coming in the way of nature's forces? In what way he is disturbing the trends of nature? And what are the results that are possible in the future? And wherever he finds dangers in the future by his own behavior, he will be able to rectify himself, stop those dangerous lines along which he is traveling now, and proceed in the lines that are not dangerous. These are the possibilities of the advent of the Aquarian age. This is what I mean by man gaining space and time. So there is a sudden hastening of the evolution of man in all planes. We find evolution proceeding in certain dimensions for the present. Certain dimensions. For example, the mental and the intellectual evolution is hastened. Then, after a certain time, another dimension takes its progress. The intellect cannot go on increasing in a unilateral way, because if the intellect develops unilaterally, then there will be an imbalanced way of progress, and there is a possibility of the human being progressing in some directions without knowing the consequences. So the progress on the intellectual plane takes place only to certain extent, and another dimension begins to progress. For example, the dimension of human morality, that is individual morality, social morality, political morality, when they begin to develop, the present misbehavior of the human kingdom will be reduced gradually. For example, the behavior of one nation towards another, towards other nations, and one country against the other countries, this will be reduced, and nations begin to behave in a responsible way. As far as the present century is concerned, we find that such a thing is not possible, because it is only the intellectual dimension that is progressing now. Similarly, there is the spiritual dimension. Like this, there are as many as 7 different dimensions that develop in the Aquarian age. And the ideal human being on the Aquarian age will be like a well-blossomed 7-petaled flower. So, for the present, the intellectual development is taking place. There is a sudden hastening of the evolution of man in all planes. It is here that the masters begin to work to make man understand better. Hierarchies will be externalized. Previously, the hierarchies were working hidden. Almost till now, they are working in a hidden way. For example, the masters of wisdom are working from the background, and almost no one has physically seen any master of wisdom except one or two. And as a result of this, there are many forgeries and falsifications also in the name of masters. That is, there are many false societies that are working in the name of the masters. You will find about 100 authors writing books claiming that they are the dictations of the master. All this will come to an end when the masters begin to externalize and their work is made public. This is the reason why the Tibetan's letter has been published in the beginning of every book of Alice Bailey. In that he said, no one need tear a book thinking that it is dictated or given by any master. That means, let there be no superstition about the work of the masters. You have no business to believe a book because it is said to have been dictated by the master. He said, even my books need not be taken like that. You read the book, and if you are convinced of it, and if you have verification by way of practical application and result, then accept the book. Then also do not accept because it is of the masters, but accept because it has the practical application and verification. There is a necessity to stress this until the hierarchy is externalized. In the future, there will be no such difficulty. In the next about 200 years, there is no possibility of falsification in the name of masters. In many countries we see now that people conducting seances and getting automatic writing and dictations, they name it after the masters. Every fellow says that I have a book dictated by Maurya or Jalpol or Hilarion. This has become a fraud now. Such a possibility and inconvenience to the humanity will not be there in the future. The sincere student now feels helpless. He does not understand whether to believe or to disbelieve. This difficulty will be removed by a safe process of externalization of the hierarchy. Discipleship and initiations are conducted in a large scale through group contacts. This already started. That is, don't understand the word initiation in a mysterious or a miraculous sense. When there is a stimulation to our consciousness on practical lines for a uniform development, that stimulation is what is called initiation. And this is time when more number of people are initiated into progress. Initiation means a hastening of human faculties. For example, when a medicine begins to act in the body of a patient, there will be a speedy recovery, speedier than normal recovery. Initiation is such like thing. The progress on the path of evolution will be hastened, and everyone can receive his own instructions from the master through a group contact. For example, we can enroll ourselves as the disciples of one of the unknown masters by showing our readiness and willingness. For example, Every day, before sleep in the night, if we mentally submit ourselves to one of the unknown masters, whom we not yet know, and show our readiness to serve the humanity, automatically there will be a contact with one of the disciples of a particular master through sleep, and the progress begins, and there will be an automatic awakening of our consciousness into a better and deeper understanding of things, and a growing mastery over our emotions, a better way of our doing things. Then, through some peculiar process, we are exposed to certain persons whose training is necessary in our life. It becomes possible for us to go certain places, where we begin to work with the required type of persons, and then our evolution will be hastened. When we conduct this process in a uniform way, and when our curiosity is not stimulated, when only the will to do good work is stimulated, then there comes a time when we are put in direct physical contact with the disciple who is guiding us. And then after some time, the disciple will put us in direct contact with one of the masters. So almost all the progress required is made possible at home. And the masters guide from a distance, and they can direct our minds towards the required degree of enlightenment. And much of the training and discipleship is completed while we are living in our own place, attending to our own expected duties. So in this respect, we have to be more careful than in the previous ages. Any attempt to leave our environment and go to strange places to meet masters, etc., will be met with serious disappointments, and the contact with wrong persons, misdirecting us towards many unnatural things, and into a blind process of self-mystification and self-fooling. We are explaining about the changes that are due to take place in the course of the Aquarian Age. We said that religions will undergo great changes. The existing religions will be broken up to pieces in an attempt to find out the only path, that is, the attempt of every race and every nation will be consciously or subconsciously to find the one path. Some individuals cooperate with this when they conduct their life activity in cooperation with the trend of things that is taking place. But those who are not able to understand the changing trends will feel a helplessness to which they have to succumb and make a forced acceptance of changing things. So there are two trends taking place during the course of the Aquarian Age. The one is the willful cooperation, and the other is the inevitability due to necessity. For the advanced, the first experience will be there. But for the less advanced human beings, a process of succumbing to inevitability of circumstances. Both lead to the same circumstances. That is, the fusion of human values to direct them into one unified direction. So, the concepts of races, nations and governments undergo big convulsions. For example, human races were understood in a different way before the advent of the Aquarian Age. They were understood in the light of the science of anthropology. For example, the structure, shape and size of the brain and the size of the skeleton was used as a means to decide the race and nation. Because before the advent of the modern spiritual institutions, the concept of evolution was quite different. It was rather Darwinian in its nature. When after a time the spiritual concept has come for the first time into existence through the writings of H.P. Blavatsky, there was a big revolution and uproar about the theory of evolution. Even now, there is a conflict between the two concepts of evolution. One is the concept of the natural students or biology students and students of anthropology that has been accepted in the universities. But at the same time, that is not enough to cater the needs of solving problems. For example, it explains the evolution of form, assuming that the forms are taking a change by themselves. And if you question whether the change is conscious or unconscious, there is no answer in the Darwinian theory. Whereas in the spiritual theory, which has been rediscovered and made popular, the concept of evolution is understood as a double process. That is, evolution of mind and evolution of matter. And the theory of descent and ascent has been for the first time accepted once again as a necessity to provide all the dimensions of human understanding. For example, the all consciousness which we call God descends into grasser and grasser level, making each level smaller and smaller in the dimensions until it finds its place in grossest matter. Then the consciousness of the divine becomes dormant in the units of matter, and a sleep-like state of consciousness exists in what we call the atoms of matter. Then the descent stops, and there is the turning point for the ascent, when each unit of matter, which we call atom, takes its path of ascendancy in degrees of increasing awareness and consciousness, until it undergoes the evolution of consciousness, when it becomes self-conscious in the stage of the human birth, and then finds itself in the middle of the descending and the ascending path, and then it makes a conscious blend of the two paths, making a willful ascendancy into the divine principle and also accepting a descendancy into matter in the form of the cycles of rebirth, making a sacrifice for the benefit of the junior soul. This is the sum total of the spiritual theory of evolution, that is, the realization of the two arcs, the arc of descent and the arc of ascent, with the human birth as the fulcrum or the turning point. So, this theory has been once again introduced, equinoxes entered into Aquarius. For example, the first printing of the book Isis Unveiled, written by Madam Blavatsky, it marked the first advent of the Aquarian Age. Until then, the theory of the biologists was in vogue. It was being followed, though it did not cater all the intellectual needs of the human mind. Even then, there is much opposition existing till today, because it takes some time for the human being to adapt into the Aquarian way of thinking. So in every field, in the field of religion, science, etc., there are big changes occurring. The concept of
rated by the first time is understood in the light of the theory of the seven root races and the cycles of biological kingdom on this earth were for the first time understood in the light of the period called Manvantara and Great Age and the theory of the seven root manus and feed manus producing seven basic races of human beings on this earth and the position of the present race of mankind and its seven sub-races and how the fifth sub-race is presently taking its course of living. All these theories receded into the background and existed only in the scriptures and wisdom books, and before the advent of the Aquarian age they were understood as fables and fairy stories and understood that they were the imagination of certain holy people in the past. Once again there is a growing awareness into that dimension, and now if one speaks of the human races on this earth, immediately in our mind the theory of the seven races and sub-races exists. This is one of the effects of the Aquarian age, and also the concepts of nation. Previously there was a certain amount of rigidity in understanding the various nations. That is, the demarcation lines between a nation and another nation was very strong. After the advent of the there is a sudden expansion of the national spirit into international spirit, and there is an essential disruption of the principle of national spirit, and what we call the spirit of patriotism has received a big blow after the Aquarian age has come. But of course there will be a middle path in understanding in the future, because in the beginning of any age there will be extremes of understanding. On one side there are the intellectual black magicians trying to control the whole humanity in terms of political and financial power. And there is a simulation of the evil forces also suddenly. So from one side there is the expansion of the international spirit, from the other side there is the international political policies that are highly dangerous and disruptive to the values of humanity. So a critical period has occurred to humanity, having good principles sometimes applied in a very negative manner. For example, nationalism is considered as a primitive trait, and this is very highly dangerous and disruptive. Now, last year in my last lecture I warned you, an international spirit without a national spirit is highly negative and false in its value, and this is to be once again understood in the Aquarian age. Unless the members of a nation have a positive national spirit, unless they know how to respect their nation, galvanize their nation with ennobling spirit, there is no possibility of themselves meeting with the members of another nation except in terms of negative and dangerous political times. So, without a strong spirit of positive nationalism,